Tech support was a web challenge from the Google CTF 2020. In the end, 90 teams solved it. I was part of solving this for our team Alice, but it was definitely a team effort. So let's have a look. Try chatting with tech support about getting a flag. And here's the URL. So let's quickly get an overview of the application. I also already have Burp set up to see what the app is doing. Let's first register an account. My username, my password, register. Okay, we see the post request also here. Now login, my username and my password. Cool. Then we find here an address field. So let's try a simple XSS, image on error, submit. And we have here a XSS. Cool. Then we have this chat now functionality where we can chat with tech support. Let's try another XSS payload here, but we also need to get past this captcha. This is also typical for CTF challenges with a bot, because on the server they have a bot that has to open the browser so you can attack it with XSS, and this is very resource intensive and you don't want people to DOS that. So with a captcha, you make sure only very few requests are allowed. But what the heck is going on? I can't get past this captcha. Let me speed this up. This was ridiculous. See how long I keep trying? What the heck? Is this maybe the actual challenge? Get past recapture? Oh man. Well, eventually it worked. And then I could submit the test XSS, which triggered. Cool. So looks like we have easy XSS here as well. Oh, and do you notice the flag menu up here? So this is apparently where the flag is. Only the chat user's account has flag. So we need to XSS the chat support and use the XSS to read the flag. There's only one last thing I want to explore before we try the XSS. We also have a signed cookie, which is base64, and we can decode it. This contains a CSRF token, our username, the address for the XSS, and the flag. We can't change the cookie by hand because it's protected by a signature and we don't know how to generate a valid signature, but it also wouldn't help us. The flag is clearly stored in the cookie of the chat support. Anyway, the XSS seems simple, right? Let's try it. I used the developer tools to help me craft the XSS payload, basically write the JavaScript code I want the XSS to do. So first I want a fetch call to get the /flag page. Then I have the response object and I want to access the text response. And then with the text response, I can do another fetch request to a request bin where I can receive the leak. I simply base64 encode the flag page and send it. And you can see here in the request bin that the base64 encoded flag arrived. This looks a bit crazy, but with the JS Beautify it looks a bit nicer. But we want it to be compact for the XSS. So let's try it. I also like to convert the payload to base64 and then the XSS decodes and evals it, because then I can avoid some issues with the encoding or escaping of special characters. Let's submit the XSS in the support reason, but we get this error in the console. Failed to load resource. The server responded with a status of 404, not found. But why? We tested the fetch and leak before and it worked. This actually took me ages to realize. Look at the domain. It's type self-sub dash support, not just type self-sub. It turns out the chat is being executed on a different domain. The XSS fires not on the main page. If you look at the support page, you can see the chat is in an iframe, and inside the iframe we can find our XSS. In the DevTools console, we can also switch the context of the execution from top to the chat domain. Now the JavaScript we type here is executed in the context of the embedded chat. And when we try to fetch our payload again, we get the same 404 error. So maybe we could use the full URL, but then we get coarse errors, because we cannot fetch the content of a page from a different domain. It's just a subdomain, but still a different domain. If we use the mode no coarse option, the request works, but it only works because the browser does not send cookies with, which means then we don't get the flag because we are not authenticated. So this is a problem. All of this will not work. And this is where the actual challenge starts. So we have XSS on the chat domain, but we need to get the flag from the main domain. We actually have a XSS on the main domain. It was here in the profile, but it's a self-XSS. It only affects our current user. But this already gives me enough building blocks to plan the attack. there's a well-known trick how to turn a self-xss into a serious xss issue. So this might be useful for bug bounty folks too, who find a self-xss and need to turn it into something usable. Let me visualize what the xss payload could do. Here I have the chat domain, and we can imagine we can do xss stuff on here. So our xss payload could first load slash flag into an iframe. Just to visualize, I also changed the flag here by hand. So the chatbot would now have loaded the flag. Then we could somehow force login the victim into our account, which means there is an XSS on the main domain in the profile. If we have done that, we can load a second iframe with our profile slash me that then executes the apparent self-XSS. And this JavaScript is now running on the main domain. Theoretically, slash flag is now gone because we are logged into our account now, but because we loaded it previously into the other iframe, we can now use the self-xss to get into the old iframe and extract the flag. Let me show you. Here I use the console and I make sure the execution context is in the me profile iframe. In there, we could simply traverse the DOM. From this iframe, we go into the parent. We have access to all the frames. We know the first frame is our slash flag loaded frame, so we go in there and we can access the document body's text, reading the flag. Note, this is only possible because both iframes are from the same domain. You can see this if you try to access the document body from the parent, which is the chat domain. Here we would get a DOM exception, block the frame with this origin from accessing a cross origin frame. So accessing the page content in this iframe from this iframe only works because they are on the same domain. That's the trick for self-xss. If you paid attention, you might also wonder why we do that and not just steal the cookie, because the cookie contained the flag, right? Well, the problem is the session cookie is HTTP only, which means you cannot access it from JavaScript. You cannot steal it. But as you can see, we can still steal sensitive data without access to the cookie, and it wouldn't work with the self-xss stuff anyway. There's now only one puzzle piece left to pull off this attack, and this is somehow to log in the victim into our account for self-xss. Actually, there could be multiple options for this. Maybe there is a login CSRF to log in the victim into our account, or there is a CSRF on updating the profile address so we wouldn't even have to re-log the victim. These were also options some others in the team attempted to do, but at the time I also played around with the session cookie a lot and I followed a different strategy to get the victim logged into my account. You see, when you set a cookie, you can specify the domain and path where it applies to. And when we are on the chat subdomain, we are allowed to set the cookie for the parent domain with a dot in the front. This actually sets a cookie that also applies to all other subdomains under this parent. Here's an example, setting the cookie key value while being on a chat domain, but for the domain with the dot in the front. Check this out. If we go to the main domain and look at the cookies, we can see the key value cookie showing up. It's set on a different domain, but still applies to this site. If we look at the guest request that loaded the site, we can see that the browser happily attaches this cookie to the request and sends it along. This means we might be able to set the two session cookies to the cookie of our account. Let's try this. So this is our account with an alert. Let's remember this cookie. And then we log out and create a new random account. Doesn't matter. And make sure we log in. As you see, this is now a different account without a XSS. Now let's go back to our chat domain and set the cookie like we set the test cookie before. First we set the session, and then also the session signature of our old account. If we now go to our main page and refresh, we don't immediately see anything, but you can see the cookies are now both set. And if we look at the raw request in burp, we see that the browser sent all cookies, old and new ones. Now look at this, if we log out this user, we still remain logged in. It shows the profile and flag menu point. And when we now go to the profile, the XSS is executed. The logout invalidated the real session cookies and now our injected ones take over. We are logged in as the old user. Cool. Now we just have to put everything together and we should get the flag. Let me show you my solution. This is the XSS payload we enter into the chat reason. It's an image that triggers this on error execution and it evals whatever is encoded here. So let me decode it and beautify the JavaScript and look at it closer. First, some headers are prepared, but ignore that for now. This function L I'm defining is a logger function that helps to debug the payload. It simply takes a parameter m, a message, and then it executes a fetch to a URL that we control, and it appends that m. So whenever we call L with a message, we receive that. This helps to verify which steps were executed in what order. It's just debugging. And what follows is a list of set timeouts that execute at different times to give each step a bit of time to load. The first one to execute is load flag, which simply creates the iframe that loads the flag. A short moment later, we set the two cookies to our account. Ignore this for now. Then we log out the user by simply loading an image with the logout URL, followed by loading the profile with the self-xss in another iframe. For the whole picture, it's also important to look at the code of the self-xss, which we know is encoded in the session. So let's look at it. As you can see, I actually put the XSS into the username, not the address. No particular reason. When I was working on this, I just noticed the username also has XSS on the profile. If it's in the address or username, makes no difference. More importantly, the self-xss simply loads another JavaScript file. So that's just for convenience. If we do it like this, we don't always have to change the session. If we want to change the payload, we can just write whatever code we want into that script. And yeah, that just fetches the flag from the other iframe and sends it to us. Cool. Only problem was, it didn't work. It worked locally when we tested it, but not when submitting it to the bot. But we also knew that there was an update by the organizers. Note, we have received multiple reports of exploits not working remotely, but we triple checked and concluded that the bot is working properly. So we knew there was some other kind of issue going on with our exploit, and I probably would have failed the challenge here because I think I would have never realized this. But Mana Germain from our team noticed something. The cache control header is set to private, and according to the Mozilla developer docs, a private browser cache may store the response in this case. And we thought that maybe when we tried to load the self-xss on /me, we got the cached response with the profile of the original user, so no self-xss. And I didn't know how to deal with that, but Managamer thought of a trick using fetch, where you add cache control headers where you specify no cache. This request should then load the new logged in user's profile, and then when we embed it with an iframe later, it should work. And when I added this, it did work. Here I'm looking at the leaked request from the XSS. We get the base64 encoded leaked string. I decode it, and there is the flag. CTF, self-xss, that isn't a problem, right? We submit it, flag captured. We were the 39th team to solve it. Cool. But now that I look at my code again, I notice that this cache buster fetch request was completely effed up. Look at this. I apparently did a copy and paste file. I'm fetching iframe source blah. This of course does not fetch the /me profile. So was this useless? Maybe the issue wasn't even a cache issue. In another write-up by 0xParrot, I also can find no words about caching, and it's basically the same exploit. Maybe it was just a timing issue, not enough time to load between those timeouts or whatever. So no clue. But in the end, still solved it, who cares?